Right. What if I told you that there was a photograph that had Bhimsen Joshi, Kumar Gandharv and Malkarman Mansoor taken by Pandit Jasraj? Right? You would have grabbed, you would have been curious when, what, where. And at a concert they all performed together. It would have been a collector's piece. What if I told you there was a photograph that had Federer, Nadal and Djokovic together taken by Andy Murray? It would have been a collector's piece. Recently there was a big photograph, very nice one, tender one of Vajpayee ji with Advani and Shekhawat. Did the rounds viral. Why? Because these are our concepts of heroes. Now have a look at this grainy photograph. It has Vijayant Thapar. It has Vivek Gupta. It has Padampani Acharya. Taken by Kongruz. In this photograph, two Mahavir Chakra, one Veer Chakra winner. Photograph taken by a Mahavir Chakra winner. All four posthumous. All four in the Battle of Tololing. And yet, this grainy photograph will remain in some part of WhatsApp groups, not finding a place in national imagination. Reason it does not find a place in national imagination is our concept of heroes is so limited that we don't go beyond a certain idea of who are the heroes. And when our concept of heroes is limited, you can imagine that the maritime word is very far off. These are chaps who did their heroism in the hills. Our maritime heroes do it much far off in the seas beyond. So they get even lesser attention. And one part of the problem that we have maritime blindness in our country is because we don't have maritime education. All of us here are in a sense imposters who've come from continental backgrounds. A chap like me joined the Navy and saw the sea then. You know, we're all trying to imagine sea well into our adulthood because we never grew up with any sort of maritime consciousness. And we did not grow up with maritime consciousness because there was nothing in our education system that asked for maritime consciousness. Now this is something that I do every time. I go to schools and colleges, I flash this, I say, recognize this chap, everyone recognizes him. I say, recognize these three people, there's sannata, silence. Nobody recognizes. One gentleman, Dilip Donde, the first man, the one with the wheel, the bearded guy, first guy to sail around the world, solo circumnavigation. Abhilash Tomy went one step further, non-stop solo circumnavigation. These two guys, incidentally, the club of circumnavigators is smaller than the club of those people who've climbed Mount Everest or gone into outer space. And we got two Indians in that club. The third man, Satyabrata Adam, the only guy in the world who's climbed both, who's been to both the poles and climbed Mount Everest three times, dived in all the six or seven oceans, climbed the peaks of all the continents. Indian Navy officer, submariner, retired guy, writes well. We don't know him at all. Now the thing is, these guys are actually natural adventurers. They've never bothered to write. They don't want Bharat Ratnas. They don't want anything. They're happy doing what they are at sea or in the peaks. But what about the rest of us? We don't know these guys at all. We will know, I mean, even instead of Shikhar Dhawan, I'd put Ajit Agarkar. With no disrespect to him, all of us would have recognized him. Right? Now that's the problem in our perceptions, and that's because our maritime education. Now all of us know this slide, but look at that. 600 or so mainland islands. How many of us know this bit of statistic? Or this, when you say 2.1 million square kilometer EEZ, it's a statistic. When you say it's two-thirds India's land area, the humongousness of the challenge comes in. And when you say if the continental shelf principle comes in and our EZ becomes 3 million square kilometers, we're talking of the same as our land area. But try telling this to someone. And I'm saying this, ladies and gentlemen, because the enormity of things that we talk about, one reason why it doesn't get registered is because we are essentially continental people with a great deal of what everyone calls sea blindness, and what I would like to add also is cartographic cataract, because we don't even know enough in regard to our sea coast, in regard to our borderlines, in regard to a whole lot of survey issues that we do. History. Earlier politicians used to sail on ships. This has three prime ministers in one photograph. This was when Pandit Nehru sailed on INS Delhi all the way to Indonesia. Sardar Patel used to sail once or twice on Delhi. He went, in fact, the first time Sardar Patel ventured, he crossed Goa. It was under Portuguese rule, and he actually told his guys, why don't we go in and invade and, you know, take this chap off. That was his kind of patriotic fervor. Now, you see, these days politicians no longer go, though of course, thankfully, Prime Minister Modi, the first time he went out of Delhi in his prime ministerial tenure, he went on board the Vikramaditya for a commander's conference. But, you know, you have moved far off from the days when the surrender of forces used to happen on the deck of ships, when UN agreement, the decision to form UN was done on ships. Now, all of that has gone. Therefore, as the sea recedes from the imagination of our politicians and bureaucrats, obviously, maritime education is going to be the casualty. All of us know this famous picture. All of us know Aurora. All of us know that. But that portly naval officer behind, Krishnan, supposedly one of the most brilliant naval officers ever this country had. And he's a World War II Gallantry Award winner, a DSO, in a gun duel with an Iranian captain. World War II hero. He's the man that fictitious and rather stupid movie called Ghazi Attack, the guy who lured Ghazi into doom is Admiral Krishnan. But please tell me how many of you would have read one chapter on Admiral Krishnan, and he was brilliant, absolutely. Ultimately, poor chap had to write his own autobiography, and he passed away, so his son completed it. Nobody writes about these kind of people. Outsiders recognize us the moment we build an indigenous ship. This cover in 1989 April happened when we had Vikrant, when we had everything, but we had taken action in Maldives, and it was the Godavari. It was a ship indigenously built by India. That is why Godavari came on the cover. The moment like yoga outsiders recognize, we say, great, Indian Navy is growing. This was a simple thing. On the day that 2 years ago, 1.5 years ago, whole of Bombay was asked to sleep and not go to schools and colleges, so many of Indian Navy and Coast Guard ships were out. Now, the reason I'm bringing this out is not to say we did it. That's not the point. It's our job. We bloody well do it. The point is, how much are the rest of people aware? Not for advertising, but for education. Look at what people did, naval pilots did in Op Madad. They actually went on top of houses. You know, they went on top of houses, did flying in conditions that the machines actually would have protested. You have Commander Naik here, he will tell you much more about the way Indian, be it Army, Air Force, Navy guys, constantly operate the machine to their limits. These two guys have got some award from the government of Philippines. You know, but again, you ask them, they will probably be guys whom, you know, Inox in Kochi will also not give them an extra ticket when they go there for a queue next time. Now, bunch of naval heroes, each one of them, I'm talking of naval chiefs, each one of them an icon, each one of them has done something fantastic. I am, you know, really hurrying up. So I'm not taking time from Admiral Chatterjee, Admiral Nanda. Each one of these is a hero worth writing about. You know, Gurcharan Das has written a book called India Grows at Night. The Indian Navy actually in 70 years has been a silent service that's suddenly grown from being less than six ships in 1947 to amongst the four or five largest navies in the world. And nobody has noticed and say, how the hell did this happen? And it has happened due to some remarkable visionaries. They were in the same league as Vikram Sarabhai or Homi Bhabha or M.S. Swaminathan. But again, because the maritime world is beyond everyone else's, we don't know, we don't notice. I have told Admiral Awati, father of ocean sailing, Admiral Mihir Roy, the father of nuclear submarine being, and each one of them led remarkable personal lives. They were ecumenical, they were cosmopolitan, they had a range of languages they could do, they were great adventurers, they were great raconteurs. I mean, they were remarkable people in so many ways. And we've lost out on some great, fascinating stories by not writing about these people. Just one example, ladies and gentlemen, this is an ex-Navy officer. All of us use mobile phones today, very happily. Mobile phones operate on the principle of Wi-Fi, which operates on the principle of MIMO, multiple input, multiple output. The father of MIMO is an ex-Indian Navy officer, Paul Raj. Now he's in Stanford. But how many of us know that this man, who has won both the Alexander Graham Bell and Marconi Award, considered the technical nobles, is an ex-Indian Navy officer? Genuine 24-carat Indian hero. I'm not talking of Indian naval hero. None of us know. We think Paul Raj is some South Indian film hero, you know. Some sportsman, I will this one. Look at our great historical icons. And now we have talked about, Shivaji and all, we know well. Let's pick up that lady, since this is ladies' thing. We have not talked about ladies. That one with the sword is Rani Abbakka. Now, how many of us have heard of this remarkable queen, very close to Shetty Sir's place? She is probably India's first anti-colonial freedom fighter. What does she do? Please see, 1556 to 1570, she fights the Portuguese. Not one, not two, many battles. She defeats them in each one of them, defeats them. When the Portuguese come to fight her, she defeats. She defeats the Portuguese general, kills him in battle, kills him, gives no quarter, chases him. She defeats a Portuguese admiral. She defeats a Portuguese fleet. Not having been satisfied with defeating them, she goes and raids Mangalore and kills Admiral Mascarenhas, the top Portuguese commander. She is let down by her own husband. That's why I wanted to make up with the Portuguese. She divorces him. She says, "You carry on. I don't want to do anything with you." That stupid fellow betrays her to the Portuguese. She is captured. She dies trying to escape from the prison. 15 years fighting, not giving in once. Now, I have nothing against Rani Lakshmibai. But Rani Lakshmibai happens 3 centuries later, 1857. One battle, which she does not unfortunately win. But she is a big icon, as she ought to be. But what has Rani Abbakka done not to deserve even a statue in a place next to her hometown, Ullal? People there don't know about her. Now, this is the sort of person we should be reading about in our history. Look at, the Chola Empire, our first oceanic empire, probably the first thalassocracy that India had, an empire built in the oceans. We don't study Rajendra Chola in the same breath that you do Ashoka or Akbar the Great or any other king that you think about. Okay, we named one merchant navy institution called Rajendra after Rajendra Chola, but he's not a maritime hero. For heaven's sake, he's a national hero. We got to do much more. Now, the reason we don't do much more, Nusurwanji Wadia, great builder, and tradition. We're talking of tradition, we're talking of quality control. Wadia's built the greatest tradition of shipbuilding. During Wadia's time, we were building 3 ships a year in dockyard in Mumbai. That's an average we've not been able to achieve even now. 3 ships a year. And with fantastic quality control. They took part in all the battles that Britain took. The second oldest, some say the oldest, ship afloat in the world, Trincomalee, built by the Wadias still. 6th generation of Wadias. Talk of family tradition, talk of quality control. V.O. Chidambaram Pillai, great man, the first man, in fact, to sail independently, start an Indian shipping line in 1906. All that we have done is named the port of Tuticorin after him. Genuine national hero, freedom fighter. The law of sedition was used against him to bankrupt him. He lost his complete wealth as a lawyer. You never hear of him as a freedom fighter. Another outstanding person, Valchand Hirachand. I mean, this is a man who deserves the posthumous Bharat Ratna. What has he not done? Set up HAL, set up Hindustan Shipyard, set up Valchandnagar Automobiles, and the man who, for whom we remember the Maritime Day, National Maritime Day, going to happen in a few days now. It's going to be the centenary of National Maritime Day. But I'm going to bet with you, ladies and gentlemen, if it comes in a single page, front page newspaper of any national newspaper this year, I will take the editor of that paper out for dinner in a five-star hotel. You know? So basically, we can't teach people to build a ship by going to the forest to gather wood. What India is doing now is this. What we got to do is teach them the desire for sea. Moment you teach desire for sea, all your aspects of blue economy will come into place. And to do that, just two, three minutes, we got to raise maritime consciousness. Very simple, include that in study of history everywhere. Begin with no costs at all. Include certain maritime heroes in your national syllabus. It doesn't matter even if it is what are considered epic mythology, you know, Samudra Manthana. The motto of the Indonesian Navy is Jalaseva Jayamahe, victory in the oceans. Okay? They have taken it from their ancient Indian ancestors who sailed to Indonesia. So it doesn't matter. As long as sea figured in our imagination, that should figure in this one. We must have research projects on a whole lot of contemporary, historical, naval personalities, lot of scientific studies. We had scientific, I mean, the boat, the Uru that is built in Calicut is used by people in Oman and Gulf still. Mombasa, when they do tourism, they do it on dhows. These dhows went from India, but you will never find. It's a lovely sea ride for 3 or 4 hours. They take you on a dhow because they're recreating that experience of the past. You will never have an Indian dhow. I mean, you will not even have a restaurant somewhere here. As Admiral Natkarni said, once in India, people go to the beach not to wet their feet but to eat bhelpuri, you know. So the problem is, unless we learn to wet our feet, unless we learn to have seen our veins, we're going to come up with land-centric solution to blue economy issues. We have to have more marinas, not malls, you know. We have to have a marina development. Aspirational value. Remember, cricket became aspirational after 83 World Cup, then after IPL. We got to have certain aspiration in a chap owning a small boat and taking the boat out for a spin. That is what we must have as middle class, upper middle class values. True, these are expensive in some ways, but hopefully there will be a trickle down effect there also, so that people in gullies, instead of starting to want to play cricket, they'll want to be sailing medalists or something like that. So I have put in a lot of suggestions here, development of sites, development of tourism trails to maritime places, so on and so forth. But all, and please do keep calling. I'm thankful to the MEDC, but we need to have a lot more subject matter experts from MMD, from a whole lot of those people who, as Shetty sir said, have skin in the game, so that they can come and talk and give a bit more of maritime emphasis. We need to do a lot more on the youth aspects. The Sea Cadet Corps doing brilliant work, but just limited to one place. So we got to spread maritime sports, tourism. We got to think maritime. Merchandising. One brilliant way, when the metal of Vikrant was used for selling this bike by Bajaj. Fantastic, innovative way. But you go abroad, so many places, small places, you find a whole lot of merchandising about the Navy or about the sea or maritime aspects. We haven't even, you know, touched the tip of iceberg here. So, ladies and gentlemen, unless we ingest huge doses of vitamin C, we are not going to have maritime consciousness and maritime education. Thanks a lot. Thank you so much. And